Choosing the right settings for a sounder is like selecting the correct course when sailing. It's about understanding when to rely on an automatic pilot versus steering manually. These choices have a significant impact, and today we'll explore the balance between using everything in automatic, everything in manual, or deciding which tasks are best suited to each mode. It's likely you've wondered how much the choice between automatic and manual settings truly affects your results. Many factors come into play: the fishing technique, the attention paid to the echo sounder, the general fishing conditions, and the specific functions required. For example, if you want to use the shift function to zoom near the bottom, you'll need to switch off the automatic scale and handle it manually. Let's break it down, step by step, to understand which functions are better kept automatic and which ones benefit from manual control. Each option comes with its own pros and cons, and even entry-level instruments often have features critical for accurately visualizing targets and the seabed. For instance, Furuno offers two modes that can be activated automatically, one for fishing, tailored to specific fishing needs, and one for cruising, designed for navigation or exploration. These modes adjust parameters like scale, gain, and clutter, and similar features are available across different brands. Some features, like zoom, can still be used while in automatic mode. However, others, such as shift, also known as custom scale or beginning slash end of scale, on some machines, require manual settings. To decide which functions are best in manual or automatic, consider your fishing technique, operational depth, and the capabilities of your instrument. Not all fishermen or techniques are alike. You've probably heard that the best results come from using manual settings. While this can be true in many scenarios, it's not a universal rule. For example, when searching for hotspots, forage fish, or while in transit, automatic settings may be sufficient or even advantageous. On the other hand, manual adjustments often excel during stationary fishing, such as bottom fishing or tuna drifting. Depth is another critical factor. Fishing at 20 meters requires less precise adjustments compared to targeting depths of 150 or 500 meters. At greater depths, fine-tuning becomes essential, particularly if the equipment is less advanced. Yet, in some cases, especially for less experienced or less attentive users, automatic settings can simplify the process and deliver acceptable results. Ultimately, whether manual or automatic is better depends on various circumstances. For certain types of fishing, manual settings will offer superior control. In others, automatic systems may provide useful advantages, particularly for those less skilled in equipment operation. Take time to familiarize yourself with these settings and consider your own fishing techniques and the typical conditions you face. Reviewing these concepts thoroughly will help you make informed decisions and get the most out of your equipment. The first and simplest setting to consider, likely trivial but present on nearly all instruments, is the depth scale or range. This determines how much of the water column your tool displays on the screen. The scale can be set manually or automatically. In manual mode, you specify the maximum depth, and the screen represents that area, including the bottom, or excluding it if your focus is elsewhere. For example, if you're fishing tuna over a 500-meter bottom, but only interested in the first 100 meters, you can set the scale from 0 to 100 meters in manual mode. This allows you to focus exclusively on that specific area without unnecessary clutter. When should the scale be set to automatic? In my experience, rarely. This is one of those settings I almost always recommend keeping in manual. Unlike gain, which we'll discuss later, The automatic scale often fails to adapt in a way that suits active fishing scenarios. For instance, when fishing, while drifting or anchored, an automatically changing scale can alter how targets are represented on the screen, creating unnecessary confusion. A consistent manual scale allows for better interpretation of target size and depth. Here's why. If your scale is set to 50 meters and you spot a target, then the scale automatically adjusts to 100 meters. That same target will appear half as large. This can mislead you into thinking you're observing a smaller fish, or even cause you to dismiss an important target. Frequent changes to the scale distort this relationship, particularly when fishing at varying depths, making it harder to gauge the size and significance of what you're seeing. Another reason to avoid automatic scaling is its tendency to misbehave in rough seas or during transit. If air bubbles pass under the transducer, the instrument can lose contact with the bottom, prompting it to search at increasing depths. The scale might jump from 50 to 100, then 200, or even 300 meters before reestablishing the correct depth. During this time, you lose vital information from the screen. In contrast, a manual scale set slightly deeper than the bottom, e.g., bottom at 50 meters, scale set to 60 meters, prevents this issue. While there may still be a brief signal gap due to air bubbles, the rest of the data will remain intact. Automatic scaling also presents challenges in situations like trolling with live bait. For example, if you hook a good fish and enter combat mode, leaving the boat to drift, you might not have time to constantly monitor the scale. The automatic setting could cause the instrument to change scales dynamically, leading to a false impression that the bottom remains constant when, in reality, the depth may be shifting. Without carefully reading the depth numbers, you might unknowingly approach shallow waters or an obstacle, risking the loss of your catch. This can happen particularly during high-stakes moments, like fighting a large fish, where any sudden terrain change could result in the line snapping or the fish escaping. For these reasons, keeping the depth scale in manual mode offers greater control and clarity, especially in dynamic and challenging fishing conditions. Another significant aspect to consider is that when using the automatic scale, the shift function cannot be activated. I've explained shift in detail in previous videos, but to clarify, it is not the same as zoom. Shift allows you to focus specifically on targets close to the bottom with greater precision. My advice is to maintain a clear view of the area 10 meters above the bottom, plus an additional 2 meters below, ensuring a screen range of about 10 to 15 or even 20 meters. This setup provides excellent target separation and a clear view of the bottom's topography. However, this level of detail is only possible with a manual scale. Automatic scaling must be deactivated to use shift. While the automatic scale may seem fully automated, it often requires its own settings adjustments. For example, in the TZT3 machine, you can access the menu to manage these configurations. If the scale appears incorrect, such as not displaying the bottom accurately, you can adjust settings like the scale height to fix it. My recommendation is to set the bottom near the base of the screen, leaving a small margin for clarity, but using most of the screen height to represent targets and the bottom as effectively as possible. Another key setting our machines offer is gain, also known as sensitivity. Gain is crucial for detecting fish and targets. An improper adjustment can result in missing important details. If you're not accustomed to frequently adjusting the gain manually, I suggest using it in automatic mode. Manual adjustment may seem sufficient initially, but changes in conditions such as depth variations or changes in the bottom's terrain often require recalibration. Leaving the gain in a low sensitivity state can cause you to miss or poorly detect important targets. For those who don't make regular manual adjustments, automatic gain can be a lifesaver. Most machines, including Furuno models, feature an offset setting for automatic gain. This allows you to fine-tune the sensitivity level at which the automatic system operates, balancing it to suit your fishing technique and the specific environment. To adjust this offset, you can enter the settings menu, increase or decrease the sensitivity, and find the optimal balance. This way, even with automatic gain, you can achieve reliable results tailored to your needs. Lastly, it is essential to ensure that the boat's environment remains free of disturbances, such as electrical noise, which can interfere with the sounder's performance. Properly managing these settings will help you maximize your machine's potential and ensure consistent results on the water. If there are disturbances on the boat, many of these adjustments become ineffective because interference forces us to lower the gain. A low gain setting means losing all targets, which is a critical issue. Another consideration against keeping gain in automatic mode is the need to fine-tune it when spotting a target on the screen. By fine-tuning, I mean adjusting the gain to better understand the size and nature of a mark that appears, even if the fish isn't directly under the boat, but slightly off to the side. In manual mode, you can increase or decrease the gain in real time to focus on and clarify targets, making it easier to assess their actual size. If the gain is in automatic mode, you first need to disable the automatic setting through the menu before making adjustments, which can be time-consuming and impractical. This functionality is particularly useful in modern instruments that allow you to adjust gain retrospectively across the historical data displayed on the screen, not just the current echo reading. By increasing or decreasing gain, you can enhance past readings to identify targets that might have otherwise been missed. For users who aren't inclined to frequently adjust their settings, keeping gain in automatic mode is a good compromise, but only if the automatic gain is properly configured. The offset gain setting is crucial here. You can preset how much more or less sensitive the automatic gain should be, ensuring the instrument isn't overly sensitive, showing too much noise, or too insensitive, missing important targets. Gain adjustments are particularly important for detecting features like the thermocline, which can guide fishing strategies. For those who prefer more precise control, manual gain adjustments should be made every few minutes or whenever conditions such as depth or bottom features change. However, automatic gain is useful for tasks like searching for baitfish or hotspots, where constant recalibration isn't necessary. The clutter function is another key aspect. This setting helps filter out background noise, making it easier to focus on targets. For specific fishing scenarios, like squid fishing, manual clutter settings are ideal. For example, with a TZ-T3 and a CHIRP probe, like the B265 LH clutter settings between 15 and 25, or occasionally 30, work well to make squid clearly visible. However, if the focus is on general fishing, such as trolling or bait fishing, clutter can be left in automatic mode. Do note that if gain is in manual mode, clutter must also be adjusted manually. Another parameter to consider is transmission frequency, which controls how often pulses are sent toward the bottom. This can also be set to manual or automatic. Transmission frequency directly impacts definition and varies based on depth. At shallower depths, higher frequencies provide better definition. However, in deeper waters, the frequency must be lower to allow enough time for the signal to travel to the bottom and back. Using the highest possible frequency for the given depth ensures optimal performance. But this adjustment must account for the depth range to avoid signal interference or loss. In shallow water, it is always beneficial to keep the transmission speed at maximum. This setting ensures the highest definition and applies equally whether the scale or gain is in manual or automatic mode. Transmission power, labeled as PowerTex in the menu, is another crucial parameter. While I usually recommend keeping it at maximum, there are situations, especially in shallow depths of 20 to 30 meters, where reducing transmission power may be advisable. Some experts believe that the ticking noise produced by the transducer could disturb certain fish. By lowering the transmission power, this sound becomes less intense and less likely to affect fish behavior. However, it's essential to reset the power to maximum when transitioning to deeper waters or performing high-speed operations, as full power is necessary for the instrument to function effectively at greater depths. This parameter, like others, can usually be toggled between automatic and manual modes. However, many settings don't fall into these categories and require specific configurations. For example, the transducer frequency can be set to CHIRP or fixed frequencies. Using CHIRP is highly recommended as it offers superior performance compared to mono frequencies. Another important feature is color erase, which filters out the weakest colors from the display. This helps remove less significant echoes, making it easier to focus on relevant targets. Zoom functions allow you to magnify specific parts of the water column, while bottom zoom keeps the seabed consistently displayed, highlighting any targets that are separated from it. Shift is particularly valuable as it allows precise focus on areas near the bottom. With the scale set to manual and shift activated, targets close to the seabed become easier to identify and distinguish. These settings each have unique advantages and disadvantages depending on the fishing conditions. Understanding how to use them effectively is critical. For further details and explanations, I'll be preparing a comprehensive guide to outline when and why each function should be used. Thank you for watching my video all the way through. I apologize if some of the translations weren't as accurate as they could be. I'm working hard to improve my English dubbing. If you find my content interesting, I'd really appreciate it if you could give it a like and leave a comment. Your feedback means a lot to me and helps me grow. If there are any topics you'd like me to cover in future videos, just let me know in the comments. Thank you again, and I'll see you in the next video.